your life work. These racks and shelves contain a lot of books, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, perhaps millions. How do you feel about them? Do they mean something to you? Are they your friends?
The human word has no parallel in the rest of the animal kingdom. Many species have highly evolved language, but as far as we know, human beings alone can save their language. Without the written word, where would we find our history, our memory, our knowledge of ourselves and others?
It's mind-boggling. It is still just a miracle to me that this culture has somehow agreed upon marks in sand, on a page, whatever, that these marks that we can all come out of our individual minds and agree upon what that means.
Writing and reading cross the boundaries of time and distance. Without them, we are alone, isolated, as if in darkness.
Reach. Reach. I wanted to teach you. Oh, everything the earth is full of, Ellen. Everything on it, it's ours for a wink and it's gone. And what we are on it. The light we bring to it and leave behind in words. Why, you can see 5,000 years back in a light of words. Everything we feel, think, know and share in words. So not a soul is in darkness, or done with even in the grave.
Mrs. Chester, have you ever read David Copperfield?
To know whether I shall be the hero of my own life, whether I shall turn out to be the hero of my own life. Chapter 1. I am born. Whether I shall turn out to be the hero of my own life, or whether that station will be held.
Personal history and experience of David Copperfield. Chapter 1. I am born.
Whether I shall turn out to be the hero of my own life, or whether that station will be held by anybody else,
whether
these pages
that station
must show.
Will be held by anybody else, these pages must show.
With all that's ever been written down through the course of history, how on earth do we keep track of it?
We may mention the catalogers who usually work behind the scenes. They organize and interpret library collections for you readers. There are the reference librarians who help readers in their search for special information. We have the circulation librarian who organizes and supervises the distribution of books. We have librarians who serve the young people, much the same as adults are served, except that the children's levels of interest are emphasized. There are the school librarians who contribute to the educational programs of their schools. In the smaller schools, the library is usually under the supervision and direction of a teacher librarian, a challenging and rewarding job. When you have two important qualifications, love for books and love for people, you may well consider the vocation of a librarian, a vocation that gives full enjoyment to the librarian and radiates it to the public. Yes, there are many aspects to this worthwhile occupation, all of vital importance in the nation's life.
Hypatia was the last librarian of that rich period of Alexandria, and that was the period of the scholar librarians. They were the people who would be invited to the so-called White House. They were the most important people in the society, and this isn't about power. It's about an appreciation and an understanding of the role that librarians played. Alexandria became a thriving city because of the library. That's the age when a lot of things happen in mathematics, in medicine, in geography, things we still help define those different subjects and specialties today.
Hypatia was famous for her skill in mathematics, astronomy, and engineering. The library housed over 700,000 scrolls, which the librarians probably arranged by size.
Hearken to me, Theodotus, teacher of kings. I
cannot spare you. The librarians of Alexandria were also trusted advisors and even tutors to the head of state.
It is called an epilepsy because of the arching caused by the muscular spasms, the contortions. The Greeks of early times considered those who suffered from it to be favored by the gods.
The great Alexander, they say, had this falling sickness.
I've always kind of had a passion for Egyptian stuff, but my passion for hieroglyphics comes with a crossover between information architecture and the soul of information. There is a direct correlation between the ancient Egyptian scribes and their ability to put a story on a small piece of stone or even a wall using hieroglyphics, pictograms, and ideograms. If they were looking at a small stone and the pharaoh said, I need this story of this war depicted on this stone, they would look at the stone and they would look at the size and they would start to conceptualize where they needed to use pure hieroglyphics or single characters, where they needed to use the pictograms, which represent words or actions, and where they needed to use ideograms.
We like to think of the library and disassociate the librarians from the library, and it's the librarians who make the library whatever it is. The librarian holds a very important role in a society, and I would like to think that in the future that there is still this very critical and important role, keepers of the flame, whether it's the flame of democracy, whether it's the flame of freedom, whatever that flame is, that we are, in a sense, keepers of that flame, that civilizing flame.